into the prayer movement.
Amen.
I need every woman of Travail to understand that they are not here by accident.
Mm-hmm. Right. Hallelujah.
You were chosen
right.
to be here.
Mm-hmm.
You were chosen to take this class. You've been chosen to be taught at a deeper level as it pertains to what it means to be a prayer warrior.
Mm-hmm.
You've been mantled with the ministry of prayer. And we all know that there's power in agreement.
Amen.
Each of you must seek out individuals to join the International Face Down prayer movement. Then God sent me to the civil rights movement. Now, what you need to understand is I don't make a dime off of the International Face Down prayer movement.
Amen.
There's no registration fees. You'd be surprised at the people that say, well, how much does it cost to register? I want to be a part. It's not tied up in money. The sole thing that stands behind this movement is uniting the people of God all over the world in prayer.
Amen.
Most saints pray. But I'm talking collectively, praying at the same time. There's power in unity. So God took me to the civil rights movement. And he said, explain to the women of God about that movement. And how the civil rights movement, when it first started, a lot of our people didn't want a part of it. Some of them were scared. They were scared that they'd be killed. Or they were scared they'd be ostracized. Or they were scared to deviate from the norm. Even though the norm was horrible living conditions. They were scared to ruffle the feathers and shake the system up. So they backed away from the movement. Then there were those who got comfortable. And they didn't think that anything could ever be better. You would wake some of those people up out of the cemetery, they'd probably die of shock, having known that we had a black president. Because they were so conditioned in their minds that they didn't even think it would be possible for our people to excel to that level. And God showed me in Christendom, it's the same thing. This is a movement. It's not going to be easy. Even some Christians are going to have to learn to adapt, to be persuaded into the power that they can have through uniting in prayer. Why? Because they've become comfortable. Comfortable being segregated in their own churches. Well, we have prayer meeting. That's good enough. We pray twice a month. We pray every week. And that's commendable. But this is something different. This is a call to the world for us not to pray in our own church houses, for us not to just pray individually, but this is a corporate call for us to all come together and pray together as one united force all over the world. Share this with your pastors.
Amen.
If they don't receive it, then move on. Host a chapter in your apartment. Invite some warriors over. And get on your face the first Saturday of every month from 10 to 11 Eastern Standard Time. Watch God move. One person can constitute a chapter.
Amen.
We just need antennas going up all over the world.
Amen.
As many antennas as we can.
Mm-hmm.
Because God wants to move in a more miraculous way. He wants to show his people things that have never been seen on this earth realm before. Ishamanda. Things you can't even conceive. God wants to do it. He's standing ready to do it. And he's just saying, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. It takes humility to put your traditions aside. It takes humility to let go of your denominational views and say, unite with somebody that I really don't believe everything that they say, but they love Jesus. Amen. They believe in Jesus, so I'm going to pray with them.
Amen.
And I'm going to let God handle the rest of that.
Amen.
Traditions, denomination, all of that has divided the body of Christ for far too long.
Amen.
And a house divided cannot stand. God is calling all of us to unite in prayer. So I'm real excited about the Dominican because this is a whole new ball game. This crossed over into another race, if you will. Not just another nationality, but another race. Then when we left the Word Network and got in the car, checked the email and my assistant said, we've got somebody emailing us from India that wants to start a chapter. Y'all don't understand what God is doing. Then we had somebody from Delaware had emailed and said, I'm over the intercessors at my church and we want to start a chapter here in Delaware. The movement is growing. God never designed First Lady to do it by herself. He mantled me with the vision. And then he allowed me to explain it to the women of travail.
Yes.
And it's your job to take the vision and run with it.
Amen.
I shouldn't be the only one posting on Facebook. Help me welcome another chapter.
Come on.
Hey.
Each of you are commissioned now. Each of you are mantled with the ministry of prayer to bring as many people in to unite the body of Christ. We're one body.
Yes.
Amen.
We're one body. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
This is the season.
Yes, it is.
God wants to show his hand in a more powerful way. This is the season that God wants to do things we've never seen before. And he needs his people to unite in prayer so that the world can see the hand of God. The world has seen the hand of the enemy. We know the power of the enemy. God needs his people to unite so that we can show his hand and his power. Takes us to chapter 4. I'm going to divert from tradition and go into the homework last tonight because I want to set the platform for our homework. We're in chapter 4, the chapter on worship. You were to have completed reading that entire chapter. A lot of times we hear the words praise and worship coupled together. Most churches have what they call praise and worship singers. Praise and worship before, at the first of the service to set the atmosphere. Praise and worship. We hear those terms together as if they were one single act. But there is a defining difference between praise and worship. Somebody shout, there is a difference.
There is a difference.
Now, praise can concert with worship, but praise and worship are not interchangeable. What do you mean, First Lady? In other words, you cannot use one in place of the other. They accomplish two entirely different things. Go to Psalms chapter 150. We're going to read verse 6. Simple scripture that most of us know by heart. It says, let everything that hath breath do what?
Praise,
praise the Lord. So we see from this scripture that when it comes to praise, the beast of the earth can praise God.
Come on now.
When it comes to praise, the fowl in the air, they can praise God. When it comes to praise, all aquatic beings can praise God. You see, their very existence demands praise to their Creator. Many people have mastered the art of praise. When you think of how good God is to you, you shouldn't be able to keep your mouth shut.
Amen.
There ought to be a praise in your belly that you just can't keep to yourself.
Amen.
When you think of how God woke you up this morning, but other people died in their sleep, there ought to be a praise in your belly that you can't keep to yourself. When you think that you slept in a warm bed last night, when other people slept under a bridge in the cold, there ought to be a praise in your belly that you can't keep to yourself. That's praise. We praise God for the things that He does. You think about, you still have a sound mind. When other people who've gone what you went through are crazy as a bedbug, there gotta be a praise in your belly that you shouldn't be able to keep to yourself. Listen, even the sinner man can praise God. The Bible said, let everything that have breath praise God. That means if you're breathing, you can praise Him. Now, I have a slight indictment against the church. Church I grew up in did what they call silence people. I might get some emails behind this, but it's all right. I have to tell you what God told me. And we would silence them based on their mistakes that they make. And generally, it wasn't only the mistake, but it was the mistake that you could see.
Right,
you get that on the way home.
Right, amen, amen.
In other words, we all make mistakes.
Yeah.
But if you couldn't notice mine, if didn't nobody tell on me, if you couldn't see me walking around with a big belly, then it was okay.
Preach.
But when my mistake became public, I couldn't clap my hands in church.
Help, Lord.
I couldn't stand up and testify amongst the congregation. I couldn't sing praises to God in the choir. I was silenced. My praise was stripped from my mouth. I couldn't offer public worship as though I was somehow dirty and unclean, even though I may have laid on my face and cried out to God in repentance all night long. It didn't matter, because man looked at me in a different light. So the word here is, women of travail, don't ever let anybody cheat you out of your praise.
Amen. Amen.
I don't care how dark the day may be, or whatever you might have to go through, don't ever stop praising God.
Amen.
Don't ever allow the enemy to make you feel that you're not worthy to praise Him.
Come on now.
If a donkey can praise Him, most certainly you can.
Yeah.
If a fish can praise Him, most certainly you can.
Make it plain. Mm-hmm. Yes.
The enemy will try to steal your praise.
Yeah.
The Bible says that God inhabits the praises of His people.
Yes.
The Bible lets us know that those who worship God, though, must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Now, worship is another realm from praise. Turn to John chapter 4. We're going to read verses 23 through 24. It's important as women of travail and as intercessors and women that God is going to use to cross this nation and the world, to carry his word, to carry the mantle of prayer. It's important that we understand what we're doing. It's also important that we learn to be genuine, authentic, true worshipers. John 4 and 23. We're going to read 23 and 24. Read. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father. How? In spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. He's looking, y'all. He's looking for somebody that's going to really give him some true worship. Not just some mouth service. Not just some tears. Not just some tongues. But some true worship. Oh, but I thought all of that was worship. Keep reading. God is a spirit. They that worship him must worship him. Somebody said must. It's not an option. Shout must. Worship him. Read. In spirit and in truth. I found that many Christians, they know how to praise God. We've become professional praisers. We know how to pick them up and put them down. We know how to clap on the right beat, some of us. Some of our other brothers and sisters clap on the other beat. But we know how to do it. We know how to play the tambourine and the instruments. We know how to praise. We've been taught to praise God in spite of our situation. Praise him through our struggle. We know how to praise him. What about worship? You see, may I submit to you that it's easier to praise than it is to worship. Not everybody can worship God because genuine worship requires spirit and truth. Everybody that has breath can't worship God. Because it requires spirit and truth. Genuine worship requires the building of your faith. Genuine worship requires you not only to know truth, but it requires you to operate in truth. There is a difference between knowing something and operating in it. Many of us are set under the word all of our lives. We can quote scriptures like the back of our hand. But do we operate in truth? Truth can only be found in the word of God. So therefore we know with great certainty that worship is a lifestyle. Go to Romans 11 and 29. We've got to see this. Because even many of our worshipers, may I submit to you, that lead songs on Sunday mornings are not authentic worshipers. They're just good singers. They're gifted and they're talented. But they're not worshipers.
Help us.
Romans 11 and 29, it reads, for the gifts and the callings of God are what? Without repentance. That means you can be in somebody else's bed on Saturday night. Get up in that mic on Sunday morning and sing the heavens down. That don't make you a worshiper. It just makes you a gifted singer. And gifts and callings come without repentance. You may angels. You may be able to speak in more tongues than Paul. You may be able to outshout David. But your gifts and your callings are not worship.
Come on, now.
Your tongues and your shout are not worship. It grieves me when I see people say, oh, we're really worshiping because the church is up in a dance. That's not authentic worship. Just another form of praise. We've gotten really good at being emotional, church. But real worship will supersede your flesh. And in order to be a woman of travail, in order to be a real intercessor, in order to really slay some demons, you must be a worshiper. Put your hand on your chest and say, Lord,
make me
a vessel of worship.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
So God said, I want you today to go back to the basics, the very basics. True worshiper. And in chapter 4 of our text, we talk about what the world calls victimless crimes. That's an act that may be morally wrong, according to Scripture. But the world says that because it doesn't hurt anybody, therefore, in many cases, we'll go ahead and just make it legal. Because it's a victimless crime. Well, women of travail, God said, tell my women that there are no victimless crimes.
Amen.
The world calls it crime. Sin. And wherever sin is, there will always be a victim. There will always be a price to pay. Turn to Romans 6 and 21. We are to obey the rules of the land, the laws of the land. But when those laws contradict biblical law, we're no longer held by those laws. We have one law, and it's the word of God. And that's what we are to be held accountable to. Romans 6, 21 through 23, read.
What fruit have ye made in those things whereof ye are now ashamed?
What good came out of stuff that you did when you wasn't saved? What good, even though it may have felt good for a season, what good can you go back and say really happened out of your mess? What fruit did it bear? Read. Read.
But now being made free from sin and become servants to God. You have your fruit unto holiness. And the end of everlasting life.
Everlasting life. So the price has been paid. There's a price for sin. Jesus paid it with his blood. And so now our sins have been washed away. And our sins, both past, present, and future, are under the blood of Jesus. Read.
For the wages of sin is death.
The wages of what?
Sin is death.
Sin will always cost you something. What does it cost you?
Death.
Read.
But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
But because of Jesus, we'll never die.
Thank you.
Woo! Think about that. This is how he showed it to me. How many of you have ever been in surgery before? When they put that mask over your face, and you're looking at them and they tell you countdown, and you start, Imashanda, and you start with 10, and you don't remember getting to 1, because somewhere between 10 and 1, you out. But then when you wake up, you don't remember the cut. You don't remember the 8 hours that you laid on that gurney and had the surgery. You just wake up and everything that needed to be done is done.
My God, thank you.
For the Christian, that's what death is like. You just go to sleep. Count down, and when you wake up, you'll see the face of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
When y'all grasp that concept, won't nobody be scared of dying.
No.
Don't mean we don't want to leave, because I don't want to be cheated out of my inheritance.
Amen.
I still got some souls that need to be saved.
Amen.
I got a word in my belly that needs to be shared. I got a mansion that I want some nice stuff in. I want some more stars in my crown. I want more crowns. You know we get more than one. Just read Revelations. So I'm not in a hurry. But guess what? I'm not scared.
Amen.
Because I know exactly what's going to happen. I'm going to sleep.
That's good. And
I won't know any. For all of y'all think you're talking to Grandma at the end of the bed at night. No, you're not. Grandma, if she was saved, she'd sleep. She ain't studying you. The same way you don't know what's going on when you sleep, neither does she. And God strictly speaks against talking to the dead anyway. So if you see Grandma, tell her, Mama, go back to sleep because I can't talk to you. I'm trying to help somebody. I thought I saw my daddy. I've dreamed of my mother and my grandmother. All are gone. It's not unreal. They're memories. There's a love connection. It's not unusual that they pop back in. But to think that Grandma is somewhere lingering around watching everything you do, it's just simply not biblical. The Bible says she sleep.
That's the Bible.
She's resting. Grandma don't need to be burdened down with every mistake you make. She don't need to see you. She's at rest. There was a quote from Ted Koppel. Y'all remember him from Nightline? ABC News anchor. I had it in the book, but I had to just rehash this quote because it was so powerful. Because we don't look at Ted Koppel as a minister of the gospel. But he has a voice. He has an international voice. And so he's invited to speak at graduations. And people listen to Ted Koppel because they know he knows a thing or two. And this is what he said. He said, in its purest form, truth. Remember, we got to worship him in what?
Spirit
and
truth.
In its purest form. Truth is not a polite tap on the shoulder.
That's what he
said. It's a howling reproach. He said what Moses brought down from Mount Sinai was not the 10 suggestions.
Come on.
He said they were the 10 commandments. And they tell us what is right from what is wrong.
Right.
So for all you Christians under the sound of my voice who feel like the Ten Commandments were just for the Old Testament saints, and now that Jesus Christ has shed his blood, we're free of the law, free of living right, free of following the word of God in the Old Testament. Somebody shout, the devil is a liar.
The devil is a liar.
I told y'all last week, is for us to live by. And everything points us to Jesus.
Yes.
So, women of travail, many people in the church are trying to adapt the world's views. God has instructed us tonight to revisit his views.
Amen.
Turn to Exodus chapter 20. We're going to revisit his views. Most of you learned these as a child. Somewhere along the way, the world is trying to get us to deny the laws of God. Now it's even filtrated into the church, trying to make us believe that his laws are null and void because of grace. If you're going to be a woman of travail, you have to understand what's required of you. Exodus 20, I want you to start with verse 17. Read that. When God spake all these words, saying,
thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife.
Okay, I'm too far. I need to go up to, I want to go where it says, and God spake all these words, saying, I'm the Lord thy God, which hath brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Okay, verse 2. Let's go to verse 2.
I am the Lord thy God.
Uh-huh. Which hath brought thee
out of the land of Egypt.
Out of?
Out of the house of bondage.
You have been bought out of Egypt. In other words, you've been bought by the blood of Jesus out of sin. You're no longer in bondage. What does that mean? That means when I make a mistake, I don't have to worry about going to hell.
Amen.
Because I'm saved and I'm washed by the blood.
Yes.
But does that give me the license to operate in my failure?
No.
No. Read number the next verse. Women of travail, we must always check ourselves to make sure that there's nothing and no one else that we're putting before God.
Amen.
My grandmother told me years ago, she said, I pray every day that I don't love your children so much. And I thought that was a weird prayer because I wanted my grandmother to love my kids. And she was crazy about my kids. But she said, I don't want to put them above God because I don't want God to take them.
Amen.
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 Then I began to have respect for her and to really understand what she was saying. When we put our children even above God and the things of God, then we put them in a dangerous position.
Right.
And
true.
We leave them subject because God is a jealous God and he won't have anything.
Amen.
Somebody shout nothing.
Nothing.
Not even your babies can come before God.
Right.
Read the next verse.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above.
Uh-huh.
That is in the earth
Uh-huh. Read.
The earth.
Keep reading.
Thou shalt not bow down thyself to him.
Uh-huh.
Or serve him.
Uh-huh.
I, the Lord thy God, am jealous God.
Jealous God. Upon the children, third and fourth generation, them that hate me. And here's the good part: showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me, keep my commandments. So to all of us who go to the nail shop and there's a big fat green man with a huge belly sitting on the counter, that's what they're talking about. How many of us have ever taken the time to open our mouth and share with our Vietnamese brothers and sisters, Chinese, Japanese, whatever they are, in your salon, most of them I've found in the places I go are Vietnamese. How many have we shared Jesus with? Or do we look at them like, well, that's a different culture. They got their own Buddha. We're going to leave them alone. We're just going to be good Christians. If they ask me something, I might tell them. I'll just tip them well and be nice. Is why God put them in your path? Is that why God put you on this earth? To let people worship and bow down to graven images? And you patronize them? You support them? And never share Jesus? I'm guilty. I told you, when he gives me a word, it's for me first. I gotta eat it, digest it, regurgitate it, chew on it some more, and it gets me good, and then I spit it out. We gotta do better. We gotta open our mouths and talk about Jesus, women of travail. Read the next one. Those of you that curse and take the Lord's name in vain, he's going to count you guilty. That's not pretty. I've never seen so many cussing saints.
Help, Lord.
And I got to be transparent. I don't cuss, but there's been a couple that have cussed in my presence, and I'll just kind of laugh. Like, you know, well, that's them.
Right.
Is that what I'm supposed to do?
No.
Mm-hmm. Am I supposed to even entertain that foolishness, and you're supposed to be saved?
Come on.
Then I had somebody challenge me, well, where does it say in the Bible, thou shalt not cuss? Go to Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to help somebody. And if you cuss after tonight, just know. You know better, and God's going to get you.
Come on. And I like this.
That's for all the cussing saints. I love a good comedy. God knows I do. Some of these comedians are funny, but I can't watch them because every other word is a cuss word. And I sit there, and I remember thinking at a certain point, if you would just take the cussing out, you'd still be funny.
Right.
But they feel like they have to cuss in order to get paid. Because that's what the world want to hear. But it grieves the child of God's spirit to hear that foolishness.
Yes. Yes.
Colossians 3:8, read. But now, ye also put off all these. Anger. Wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communications out of your mouth. Next time you get ready to cuss, ask God, is this clean or is it filthy?
Well,
and if it's filthy, he says, put it out. Put it off. Okay, well, give me another one. Turn to Matthew 12, and I could go on. I just don't have time. You search it out for yourself. Matthew 12 and 36. What does it have to say about your dirty mouth? Saints of God, using your mouth on Sunday to sing praises and worship to God, speak in tongues, speak your heavenly language out of that same mouth that you turn around and cuss with.
Help us.
Matthew 12 and 36. Read it.
Every idle word
that a man shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be what? Justified. And by thy words thou shalt be what? Condemned.
Amen. That's the word.
When you speak vulgarity, you're condemning yourself.
Jesus.
And you will be judged. Somebody need to shout, just speak blessings. I found that people that do a lot of cussing do it because they have a low vocabulary. Some of us just need to start studying a dictionary. You want to get somebody told, just learn some words that possibly they don't know. And then watch and see how they feel when you get through top telling them off in love. Ain't said a cuss word, but they don't feel like, well, what? Cussing shows your ignorance.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
Smart people ain't got to cuss.
No.
They'll talk you up one while and down the next, and you won't even know what hit you. Go to the next one. What's the next commandment? Remember?
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
Okay. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Read. 6 days. Shall thou labor. Somebody say six.
Six.
Read. Do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Read. In it thou shalt not do what? Any work. Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor the cattle, nor thy maiden, heaven on earth. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Nor thy stranger that is with thy gates. For what?
6 days
the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that was in them. And what? He rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. I just need you to ask the person next to you, what day of the week is it that you do absolutely nothing? Now say, ouch.
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 If you don't take nothing else home, take this one. We have gotten so busy.
Yes, we
if they offer overtime,
my God,
on any day of the week,
my God,
we taking it.
Yep.
Because we got some extra bills to pay. We got a trip we want to take.
Yes.
We never stop to think that we're disobeying the law, that we're going against the direct commandment of God. Even the ground needs a day to rest.
Yes.
That's why they say we're not as healthy as we once were or should be. Because even those of us that are vegetarians and eat vegetables and fruits and stuff, they say the vegetables today don't have near the nutrients that they had 100 years ago. Why? Because we overwork the land. Why? Because of greed. We want to keep pumping. So in order to even make the land produce, after the sixth year, they have to add chemicals to the land to even make it grow your food, because it shuts down. Even the earth obeys God. It wants to rest a year. We wonder why the precious saints are dying like flies. I'm talking early deaths. We wonder why we are enamored with all of these horrible diseases that the world has in huge proportions. We wonder why saints are depressed, despondent, suicidal. It's because you're not obeying the word of God. I don't see it. I'm saved. But you're disobeying the word of God. He said, work 6 of them days. And one day a week. Now, the Sabbath we know as Saturday. And I know we have church on Sunday. And you will have the Adventists that would say we're disobeying God because we're supposed to worship on Saturday. Our Jewish brothers and sisters would say we're going against the word of God because it says Saturday, the Sabbath. And I'm not going to argue any of that because we all know that our calendars have been adjusted. So to know even when a real Saturday is would be hard at best. But the principle is the same. What day? Who wakes up on a Sunday, goes to church, worship, praise, sing, fellowship, and then go home and does absolutely nothing every single Sunday. And if somebody asks you to do something, I'm sorry, it's the Sabbath. It's hallowed. Because if you're doing it on Sunday, then Sunday becomes your what? Sabbath. Don't raise your hand because I'm guilty. I'll go home from church and wash a load of clothes in between services. Help, Lord. I'll go home and when I was writing the book, I'll write some book. But listen, he said don't do nothing. Rest. It takes effort to do those things. For me, it's work because that's what I do for a living. So if you don't take nothing else, if you can't stop cussing, just know you're gonna have to pay. But if you want to live a productive life and be obedient to the word, don't allow nobody to work you on no Sunday. Amen. I'm probably in trouble for that. Because I might be cutting into some pastor's tithes and offering. Let my saints alone. They can work on Sunday as long as they pay their tithes. You met them now, First Lady Golden. You was doing all right till you started met them. I'm just preaching the word. I'm just teaching them what the word says. Everybody needs somebody shall one day to rest. Even God rested.
Yes, he did.
Go to verse 5. The next verse, whatever it is. It says honor. 12. That your days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Now, I need to set this misconception straight. It doesn't say honor your mother and father if they honored you.
Come on.
It doesn't say honor them if they were good parents. You're obligated to take care of them because they took care of you. Mama sacrificed for me when I was growing up. So now she needs me. I got to sacrifice for her. That's not what he's talking about. Yes, you should do that. But if mama treated you like a dog on the street, the Bible says honor your mother and father. If daddy never owned you as his own, the Bible says honor your mother and father. Well, how do they honor them? How do I honor them? I haven't been in touch with them. I don't know where they are. Some cases I don't know who they are. Search them out. You can't honor what you don't know. Look for them. Seek them out. Make amends. Get in touch. Swallow your pride. Ask God to heal your hurt. And honor your parents. That your days may be long on this earth. That's not something the First Lady is saying you should do. It would be nice. It would be a nice Christian gesture. No. God commands it. What's the next one? Somebody shout abortion.
Abortion.
Is murder.
Is murder.
Move on. Somebody shout pornography. Is adultery. Move on. You read it in the book. I don't have to explain it. But for all of you that don't have the book, get it. And if you don't get it, let me just kind of explain this. Because so many of the saints, especially the married ones, try to condone pornography.
Help, Lord.
And so you've got to understand that when you bring anything into the bedroom, that is another person. Because the picture of somebody or a video of somebody is that person that you're committing adultery and you're outside of the marriage covenant and it's sin. Next. Somebody shout, if I don't pay my tithes. robber.
And a robber.
Move on. The Bible says all liars, somebody shout all liars,
all liars,
shall have their part in the lake of fire. And let me tell you this, there are some lying saints. There's some lying pastors. I know one that will look you in your face, tell you it's snowing outside and the sun is shining and ain't no snow nowhere. Because he don't think you're going to go outside and check. We're laughing. But that's sad.
Right.
The blood ain't going to cover that foolishness.
No.
You can't operate in sin and think you're going to be saved. There's got to be something in you that triggers change. Go to the next one. Listen, have you ever met somebody that every time you get something, they gotta have it?
My God.
You get something, they might not even compliment you on it. They might not even say, "Oh, girl, that's cute." No. You just look up and they got it.
Right.
And you might be the kind of person that just don't want to be like everybody else, and that's okay. I admire that personally. Because
yes.
I don't believe God made us a bunch of cookie cutters.
Right.
I believe we all have our individual characters and our individual looks and likes and dispositions, and it all fits rightly in the body. But then you change your look and you turn around and they got the same one. Every time you do something, there they go. Coveting.
Right.
You get a new car, they got a new car. You move somewhere else, they done move somewhere else. Somebody shout, just be yourself.
Be yourself.
Can't nobody do you better than you. And at the end of the day, it moves from just admiring somebody to covetousness. And so, we must understand, women of Israel, that the Ten Commandments were not just written for the people who lived in the Old Testament, that were born before Jesus was born. No, they were written for all Christians to live by. We're not saved by the law. We're saved by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
But the law, women of travail, is our guideline to let us gauge what is right from what is wrong. The law shows us what sin looks like. The law shows us the nature of God and how God expects us to behave. And the more we embrace the nature of God, the more we're able to discern his voice. And women of travail, we must be able to rightly discern the voice of God if we are going to be intercessors.
Amen.
Several months ago, God told me that every time I was in an airport, he said, "I want you to pray out loud." He said, "And then I want you to take it public. Do a public video on social media, praying in a public place." And I'm not walking through those airports, and I'm not sitting in those airports. And my assistants, I got several of them that travel with me, they can tell you, "First Lady's not doing this." "Oh God, we thank you, we magnify you, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus." I'm not trying to find a corner where ain't no people. "Jesus, we just love you. Oh, have your way. Oosha, have your way, Jesus." They'll tell you, "I sit where all the people are. I get in the aisle where the people are just moving back and forth. And I pray in my normal voice. I don't make a spectacle, but I'm sure not embarrassed and I'm not trying to hide." God commissioned me to do that. That's why I can do it with boldness. So, he commissioned all of us to do it too, by the way. He said to go into the hedges and the highways. That's where the people are.
Right.
Ain't no hedges and highways in your prayer closet. That's not just my mantle, women of God. And so, I was grieved by a picture I saw. So I made what was called the public prayer challenge. I put it out there. Put it on the Women of Travail page. Put it on my personal page. And I had a handful of Women of Travail that accepted the challenge. And some of them are sitting here today, and I applaud you. But most of you did not. Then I was grieved when I saw a picture the other day of a group of Muslims all dressed in their Muslim garb, taking off their shoes because they had hallowed the ground in the airport as holy. And they had their faces down, about five or six of them that I could see, in prayer in the airport. Why were you grieved, First Lady? I was grieved because the clarion call went out to the body of Christ. And many of us didn't answer. We didn't even say that it had to be an airport. We said public prayer, just taking public. We got one lady sitting in here that did it. I believe she was at Myers, pushing her cart, doing her public prayer challenge. But even that was too much for some of us. But then we see the Muslims on their face crying out to their God. But we're supposed to be the head. We're supposed to be the ones that serve the true and living God. What is the problem? Then the Lord took my mind back to when I went to Israel. And on the flight to Israel, it was an Israeli flight, but there were both, everybody was on it. But there were a lot of Jewish people scattered all over the plane. And of course, anybody been to Israel, it's a long flight. Who's been there? What is it like, 17, 20, how many hours? 18 to 20 hours in the air straight. It's a long time. Whatever time it is that they're supposed to pray, every last one of them pulled out their prayer books. They didn't care that I was sitting next to them. They didn't care that the little American kids was looking at them laughing. They pulled out those prayer books and they began to nod and pray. Nod and pray. Nod and pray. And I began to think, God, such dedication. But what about the Christians? What are we doing? We're in our church houses, picking them up and putting them down. In some cases, making a spectacle of ourselves. I saw a picture. Yeah, okay, Holy Ghost, he said I could share it. Of somebody doing push-ups on the altar. Call themselves praising and worshiping. Because somebody said, just do something out of the normal. You want to do something out of the normal? Go out in public and pray. Begin to call on your God and your Jesus in front of the sinners. God will get more glory out of that than you doing some push-ups in the church. You're in this class, Women of Travail. You've been chosen to do more than just go to church. If you're watching this video online, you've been chosen to do more than just attend this Women of Travail class. You cannot be a scared, timid, jellyback demon slayer. I should have got more hand claps on that one.
Amen.
God didn't call you to be intimidated by the devil.
Amen.
The reason many of us aren't doing it is because we're intimidated. We're fearful. What we gonna say? People gonna think we crazy. People gonna look at, do you care what people think? Do people have a heaven or hell to put you in? Did I not tell you the story about how there's souls that you don't even know who they are that God has assigned you to? That if you don't open your mouth, they won't be saved. It could be somebody in the airport. It could be somebody in the restaurant when you sit down to eat your meal. It could be somebody in the dry cleaners. It could be somebody at the Walmart. You'll never know until judgment day. And he says, First Lady Golder commissioned you to go out to shift some things, but you kept your mouth shut. And see that one down there? Look over there at that one. They're in hell when they could have been saved, but you wouldn't share the gospel with them. So your homework assignment, and then we're going to pray. Your homework assignment next week, each of you are to post a video of yourself on Facebook praying in a public place. Your garage is not public. Your front room, oh, but everybody come over my house, that's not public. If they won't allow you to pray on your job, don't lose your job, but you go somewhere public and pray. And then you are to post the video on the WOT Facebook page. We're going to pull y'all out of all of this flesh. We're going to pull you out of your comfort zone. We're going to pull you out of fear and intimidation. Now, if you don't know how to post a live video on Facebook, ask one of your children. They will help you. Because there's not much they don't know how to do. No excuse. And then I need you to hashtag your prayer. Write it down. The hashtag is the number sign. Hashtag your prayer. Public prayer challenge. You don't put any spaces in that. It all runs together. The number sign, public prayer challenge. You can do it all in lowercase. Somebody shout, the devil is not going to get more than God is.
The devil is not going to get more than God is.
That's it. Part two of your homework. And I have people, including myself, that will be monitoring that website. I don't care when you do it, but I need at least one post between today and next Tuesday before 6 p.m. The next assignment is your worksheet on page number 25 that deals with worship. And I've given you all the answers tonight, so you should have no problem just filling that worksheet out and bringing it with you next week. Those of you that are online, screenshot it and send it via email. Are there any questions? Because I want to make sure everybody understands what's required of them. Yes.
I'm not on Facebook.
All right. You're going to need to get on it. And if you can't get on it, get with a friend that's on it. Couple up with a friend and be with her when you do your public prayer. In fact, I don't have a problem with two or three of you doing a public prayer together. And just pass the phone around and pray. We've done that before when I travel. I'll let my assistants pray some, then I'll come conclude the prayer. I don't care how you do it, but listen, here's the thing. We find a way to do everything we want to do.
Amen.
Repeat after me. Where there's a will,
there's
always
a way.
So now shout, make it happen.
Make it happen.
Make it happen. Yes, ma'am.
public prayer challenge.
Hashtag, which is the number sign. You do that first. Okay. And then public prayer challenge. Yes.
Just real quick. You said part two, we're supposed to post the worksheet on worship. We posting it or we email?
Okay. If you're an on-site student, you just bring it. You write it out in your workbook. Bring it like you always do your worksheets. Bring it with you so that you can get credit for having done it. If you are an online student, you will screen shoot it and email it in. Yes, ma'am. There is not. Listen, I'm requesting via God. I know this is a command of God because we've got to stop being so intimidated and timid and quiet. And if you're a demon slayer, you're not walking around with your head in between your knees. If you're a demon slayer, you don't care what people think about you or what they say about you. Do you think I care?
No.
No, I don't care. And when I post it on Facebook, you know, it's not like I'm just praying in front of strangers. All my friends are seeing it. God only knows what even some of the Christians are saying about me. Do I care? No. Because I'm not doing it for them. So, be led of God. That's the answer. Let God lead you. I'm making the charge. Allow God to lead. You want to get on there and preach your first sermon, you go for it, baby. And I'll put a whole bunch of hearts and amens under it for you. Yes.
Okay, so are you saying go live on the Women of Travail page, or are you saying record a video and post it on the Women of Travail?
Either way, it doesn't matter. You're probably going to have to record it and post it, because I'm not sure you can go live on the Women of Travail page.
They can go live on their personal page and post it to our page.
Okay, that's good. Go live on your personal pages. That's what you want to do anyway, because you want this prayer to be associated with you. You don't want to there again hide and say, you know, I don't know who did that. No, it was you. You did it. It's on your page for the world to see. So if you're operating where people don't even know who you are and what you stand for, after this week they will. Which means what? Some of us lives gonna have to start lining up with who we say we are. Yeah. And believe you was out there praying, you a woman of who? A what? Uh-huh. Uh-huh. I saw another hand, yes. Gotta be in public. It's gotta be in a public place. It's gotta be, can't be in private. God's calling us out, out into the world. Okay? All right. Thank you, online class. I love you. I cannot wait to hear and see you pray. And I'll see you in class on this Thursday evening at 8:15 sharp. Be blessed. I love you.